There's a saying in Montana, everything may be big in Texas, but everything's better in Montana. And from what I can see, that seems right. In the Bighorn Plateau in the southern part of Montana, the spring pasture has turned to a canvas of green, painted yellow with wild daisies, white with angel cups, and purple with painted Indian. The mountains in the distance are still covered with snow, waiting for their chance to awake from winter. Below is the Bighorn Canyon and lake, ready to drink the water from the melting snow. The Bighorn Lake is long and narrow and can really only be enjoyed from a boat.
It's 72 miles long. Runs from Fort Smith up to near Lovell, Wyoming. At this lower end down here, we're looking at depths close to 500 feet. It's narrow, and the walls are real steep, so there is a lot of water in it. Not many miles of shoreline, though.
From the water, rock formations can be seen that would go unnoticed from the shore. Eagle Eye or Steer's Head are just a few along the lake. The canyon is a very spiritual place for the Crow Indians, and a burial site for Chief Pretty Eagle.
It was around the turn of the century, I think, when he died, and his bones were taken basically back east somewhere, and they were in a museum until the Crow tribe was able to get him back, and they reburied him here, four or five years ago, up here at Pretty Eagle Point. Now, there's a nice memorial for him up there, and he was a very well thought of medicine man.
The history of the Bighorn Lake and Yellowtail Dam dates back to the mid-60s, but the history of the canyon dates back over 10,000 years.
Well, there's been man recorded here through carbon dating and testing that actually back 8,000-10,000 years ago.
The walls of the canyon are full of caves.
Well, there's different kinds of caves here. Some I've been in have limestone like stalactites and stalagmites hanging, you know, from the ceiling and coming up from the floor, quite look like icicles. And then some are real smooth walls, and actually have drawings on some of them.
Looking at the drawings, one can only wonder what the Indians saw when they drew these images. Because the access to the lake is very limited, basically just at the dam, and being located on the Crow Indian Reservation, the Bighorn Lake and shoreline should stay unspoiled for generations to come. Sean Stiles, News 8, Montana. The Battle of the Little Bighorn was a result of an order to the military to round up the hostiles in the Montana Territory. These were Indians that were not on the reservation or had left it. At the same time, Sitting Bull sent out a message by runners to the tribes of the Cheyenne and Sioux.
And told them to meet on the Greasy Grass. They've been coming here for a long time for purposes of religion. They came here on the Upper Rosebud, and they have sun dances in the spring of the year. And they were going to meet here after the sun dance and discuss what they need to do about the reservation system.
During this time, Custer was in the Lone Teepee area near the Greasy Grass, where his scouts spotted a gathering of Indians. Custer placed Major Reno above the Little Bighorn River and moved 5 miles north. The ridge is dotted with markers where soldiers fell fighting their way back to Major Reno. His plan was to capture the women and children as hostages. But before Custer could do anything, he found himself in a battle with the Indian warriors. The number of Indian warriors, according to oral historians, is between 2,000 and 5,000.
The soldiers were definitely outgunned and outmanned. The soldiers had a 45-70s, which was not a smokeless powder rifle. They could get maybe two shots off before they had to move and get out of the smoke. Whereas the Indians had the repeaters. They even had bows and arrows. They had many different types of weapons they used. And so it was relatively easy for them to pin these folks down and kill them all. One of the misconceptions that I think that people have about this place is that the end of the battle was here on what we call Custer Hill, or by next to the monument. That's just not the case. The end of the battle took place down at Deep Ravine. You can see the white markers, the headstones.
The memorial atop Custer Hill was built in 1881, honoring the fallen soldiers of the 7th Cavalry. There are plans to build a second memorial in memory of the Indian warriors that died here as well.
They have finished up with a design competition. We do have a design winner, and it was accepted by the Secretary of Interior, Bruce Babbitt, about a month ago. That particular monument is going to sit right down from the existing memorial. It is not there for a competition purpose. It is there to complement this particular memorial. They will complement one another.
The two monuments will be linked together through a spirit path, and the theme of the two memorials will be peace through unity. Sean Stiles, KFMB News 8, Montana. There's a saying, the worst day of fishing is better than the best day at work. And the Bighorn River in Montana must be the place where that saying came from. But just to make sure we have a great time fishing, we'll be staying at the Eagle Nest Lodge. The lodge is family owned and operated, and everybody does their part.
My main goal was just comfort. I take care of the lodge, the inside of the lodge, and just the outside, just making them feel comfortable, making it feel like this is their home, they're at somebody's house to stay.
We just want everybody to feel like they're part of the family and to have a meal that they would have at home if they had the time and energy to do it. And it's, we think something that's missing from when you eat out. It's not fancy French gourmet food.
Our entree is a teriyaki filet mignon with a big baked potato, steamed asparagus that Keith picked down by the river this morning, and a strawberry pie for dessert.
It's old fashioned, fill you up, tastes good, Thanksgiving every day, but not necessarily a turkey dinner.
Oh boy.
Pick it up, throw it out, shoot a little bit of line.
The Kellys are second generation guides on the Bighorn, so you know they know what it takes to catch fish.
In almost all trout fishing, it's a matter of putting it down in the right spot.
A little practice now will pay off big later.
Yeah, that right there, if you can put that cast where you want it to be, you'll be successful.
The Eagle Nest Lodge was established in 1985 and has quite a reputation, which attracts people from around the world.
Well, Montana was a place I personally have always wanted to come to. And primarily we looked to end up coming here to the Eagle Nest because of my parents' interest in fishing in particular.
Well, it was Simon's idea, because he knows how much, you know, we love fishing. As you know, we go to Scotland to fish every year. And he said to us both, why don't we come and fish on the most famous river in America? So we said, righto.
And we find traditional American hospitality is just as wonderful as it ever was. And we've had a ball.
We've had a ball, yes.
And while the Glennies trip was ending, what they had to say made us more excited. The Bighorn River is one of the best trout fisheries in the country, and it doesn't take long to live up to its reputation.
$5. Alright. Everything else from now is gravy.
Of course, there's a little brotherly competition.
Sean, I appreciate you having me come to work with you today.
This type of fly fishing is called nymphing. Instead of floating our flies on the water, we try to match what is underneath, waiting to hatch.
Right now, that it's the spawning season for the rainbows, and so when they come off the beds to feed, they're very aggressive. The browns are still feeding normally. It's just that the rainbows are so aggressive right now that they're just getting to the food first.
It's also estimated that there are 8,000 trout per mile. That is maintained by an unwritten code between fish and angler.
One of the beauties of fishing a great river like this is that it's basically all catch and release, so we'll come back and catch that fish again another time.
By noon, at least 20 fish have been caught and released, and it was time for lunch. But if you're thinking just a quick break, think again. Tables, chairs, cloth napkins, where did these guys get this stuff? Stashed in a bush? Well, I guess that worldwide reputation does mean something. We're fishing about a 13-mile stretch of the Bighorn River, and it can take the better part of a day to float down. How far you make it down the river by lunch gives you a good idea how the fishing is. Today, the fishing is very good. We've only made it about 5 or so miles.
Beautiful ground.
As we make our way on the second half of our journey, you can't help but let your eyes wander.
you might have experienced it yourself. You know, you're drifting along in the boat and you're not watching your indicator half the time. You know, you're taking in the scenery. And that's part of my job, is when you're not paying attention, to pay attention.
And that's what the Kellys do, pay attention. This is what they do for a living, and it keeps them where they want to be.
You can enjoy the environment every day. It's never the same. It's never monotonous. Even on my end of it, where I'm talking to people most of the time and not spending as much time on the river as Matt is, it's ever-changing, and it's getting people excited about what we're already excited about.
But the fishing isn't the only reason people come here. This was a time for me to share with my best friend and brother.
When I fish with you, and like it's like when we ski together, you're a much better skier, and you always give me the tips and get me set up. And, you know, and I always want to see a hookup.
And it's just like fishing, I'm a much better fisherman.
Yeah, right. Just that much. But, you know what I'm saying? You just like to, you know, you want to see your brother do good, you know, and have fun and be a part of it. I hate having to, you know, take all your money in those bets, but it's all right.
And it just so happens that in a fishery like this,
it was good fishing.
Most of the people that come to our lodge are, you know, just coming to get away. They want to, you know, escape the big city life and get out here and enjoy the fresh air and the scenery. And most people seem to think that catching fish is a bonus. Most people, you know, come, expect to catch a few fish, and they end up catching, you know, a lot more than they expected.
For us, we knew the fish were here, but what we came away with was a lot more than we expected. Sean Stiles, KFMB News 8, Montana.